What's up, everyone? Welcome to another episode of the Skywatcher What's Up webcast. My name is Kevin Lagora. I'm your product specialist for Skywatcher here in North America. Here at the What's Up webcast, we take a look at everything from what's up in the nighttime sky to equipment to helpful tips and tricks. And of course, at the last Friday of the month, we have a special guest on to talk about their specialty in the field of astronomy. If you like what you see here, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. It lets us know we're doing a good job. Maybe leave a like on a video. So we can keep doing this. So it is the last Friday of the month, and I will let you know, I'm not actually here. I'm at the Grand Canyon Star Party at the moment, so this is a pre-recorded episode, which means we're going to bring in someone who's not in the time zone. So today I'm actually joined by my good friend and kind of my counterpart, at least I kind of see him that way, Will Godward. He is from Skywatcher Australia. So hey, Will, how are you doing? For you it's this morning, for me it's the evening. So.
Yeah, g'day Kevin. Yeah, thanks for having me on. It is the morning over here. It's the future, as I say.
Yes, every time we talk it's like, how's tomorrow look?
So, yeah, it's good. We have flying cars over here already.
I know. to get with the times, apparently. So
yeah, 14 hours ahead, I think.
Yeah, what a trip. So one of these days I need to get down there and just say hi. So it's a long trip to say hi, but one of these days I will get down there and see how you guys do things. So we've known each other for several years at this point. We've hung out at the factory and all that fun stuff when we get dragged all over the world. But I don't think we've ever really sat and hung out kind of like we're doing right now. So I asked the same question with everybody who comes on. How did they get started in astronomy? So what's your story?
Yeah. So my story, I think, when I was young, I was really interested in science and, you know, I was collecting bugs and looking at the stars and, you know, and doing all the cool things. And then I think it was about 1996. It was a comet. And it's probably a story for many people out there when they see a comet. It gets them going, but it was a comet for me, and it was Comet Hale-Bopp. And I remember looking through binoculars. I bought a pair of binoculars to look at it, and looking through a telescope at it, and that just got me hooked. And then from there I joined an astronomical society down here in South Australia, and you know being around like-minded people grew that passion, and it hasn't stopped since then. I think it was comet, and comets have always been my main interest as well. Going from there, from viewing Comet Hale-Bopp to Comet McNaught, another. I don't think you guys got to see that up there, but Comet.
Yeah, McNaught. We didn't get the crazy tail and everything.
No.
You guys get so spoiled with the comets down there. Like we get one and we're like, yay, and we think it's awesome, and then it goes to the Southern Hemisphere and it just throws out with everything, and it's just like, oh crap. So good for you. I'll live vicariously through you. So.
I think you guys had a good comment recently, though. Was it Neowise?
Yeah, something like that. That was like the one good one that we've had recently. Like you guys are like, oh, that's cute. We have like five that we've had in the past year, couple of years or whatever. So I just know every time there's a good one, the Southern Hemisphere, 9 times out of 10, tends to get the better view of it. So.
Yeah, it's usually one of those sun grazers coming in, and hopefully like an Aussie, like someone like Terry Lovejoy, can discover it again. They are a good show, and they do help with telescope sales as well.
Oh yeah, because everyone gets like, I gotta see it, how do I see it? And then no, that's awesome. Now you're actually quite an accomplished nightscape photographer, which I know it's kind of your specialty. I'm not sure. I don't know how the seasons work. I mean, obviously I know how the seasons work, but Milky Way season for you guys. And is it right now kind of in your winter time, our summertime?
Yeah. So our Milky Way season's now. Yeah.
Okay. So ours is the same. Mm-hmm. So with that, obviously you kind of have to take not a different approach, but you guys have a much more elaborate view of the Milky Way down south, because the core is high. Scorpio and Sagittarius are way above the horizon. You get a lot of, it's a very different perspective, where for us here it's like Scorpio and Sagittarius, at least here in the more southern part of the US, they get up and you can see it, the core is up, but there are some places, if you go north, like those barely scrape above the horizon. But for you, it's like way up there. So I didn't know if you could kind of share your experience of nightscape photography from the Southern Hemisphere. And I know you've got some cool pictures that you've shot to so people can see how credible you are.
Oh, thanks, mate. Thank you. Now, we are very blessed down here in Australia or down under. And, you know, I think it's also like, you know, South America as well, have similar skies in South Africa. But yeah, we're very lucky here. I think come around about March, we start to see the core rising in a normal hours. You can catch it in like February, like just before dawn. But around March, you start to see the core of the Milky Way rise. And then at the moment, you know, once you go outside, you know, during around about 11 o'clock at night, you know, the core of the whole stretch of the Milky Way is like at zenith, straight overhead. So you can like capture the full reach of it. And then, you know, later in the year the Milky Way, you know, come around about August, September, it starts to set over the western horizon. Then you can catch that, you know, you can get those Milky Way shots where it's like a rainbow effect or arc of the Milky Way stretching over the western horizon. And I can show you some pictures just to give you an idea of what it's like. Can you see that all right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
So this shot here, this is a shot of the Milky Way rising over the eastern horizon for us. And as you can see, you can like Scorpio's, it's quite high already. And this is taken from Bortle class 1 skies about a few hours north of where I live here. And yeah, and it's amazing to see the core. And yeah, I guess it's what everyone chases in nightscape photography.
Wants that, you know, river of stars across the sky. Do you stack your images or are they just single shots or do you composite or how do you work with that?
Yeah, so I love panoramas. And I'm not much of a stacker. I mainly shoot panoramas where I'm using like a 14 mil or a 24 mil is my main focal length. And I take multiple images. So for example, this image, I think this is around about 30 shots of the night sky and then stitched together. And it's kind of like stacking as well because you're taking the best of, you know, each image and putting it together. And then this image was tracked with a Skywatcher Star Adventurer, one of my favorite tools. But then you take the foreground and then it's kind of, you just blend the two together. But it is as what the night sky was like there and the position of the Milky Way, you know, over that land feature, exactly to, you know, what it was on that night or early hours in the morning, I think this one was. But yeah, now the Milky Way, it's another shot from... This is called the Flinders Ranges, just up about 5 hours north of Adelaide here in South Australia. And it's some of the darkest skies in South Australia and beautiful landscape, you know, untouched landscape for many years. So, yeah.
That's a big thing with Australia is I think you have a map. I know we were talking about it before this, but Australia is as big, if not maybe a bit bigger than the United States is. But when you look at the light pollution map, which I know you have, it's incredibly dark, like in comparison. Like, yeah, like 99% of the continent is black. So, with just obviously, you know, you have Perth and Adelaide and Melbourne and Sydney and Brisbane, the coastal cities are pretty much where everyone's at that point.
It is. I mean, you know, in the center part here, it's mostly desert. And, you know, sometimes in summer, it can get to 50 plus degrees Celsius. I don't know what that's in Fahrenheit. Sorry.
Hot.
It's hot. It's well over 100. Is it 120 or something Fahrenheit?
It's up there. I'd have to go and try to convert.
But it's hot. So that's why there's no one living out there. But of course, no one living out there, then, you know, it's beautiful night skies and some of the best night skies you can get out there.
Are there any particular places, like if someone wanted to come to Australia and they wanted to be able to see the Milky Way, are there any small towns that you find are like a good place to kind of base out of, where it's like, hey, I want to come in, I want to see the Milky Way, I want to go do the night sky of the Southern Hemisphere. Are there any little places that you like to go, like, that tend to be a good place?
So I live in Adelaide, down here, down the middle. And that's, you know, I live 45 minutes from the actual city of Adelaide, and I'm in border class three skies. And, you know, I can see the Milky Way easily and capture it really easily from just, you know, with 45 minutes from a main city. And, you know, somewhere, if you're Sydney, you might have to travel about, you know, about 3 to 4 hours out of Sydney. But, you know, Adelaide's a great spot for the night sky. We're very, very blessed here with really dark skies. We have a, I think it's one of the first in Australia, if not the Southern Hemisphere. It's called the River Murray Dark Sky Reserve.
Oh, okay. I was going to ask if there was any, like, certified dark sky sites.
Yeah, there's one. It's about an hour from me. And, you know, that's, I think it's about border class two or two skies or something like that. But it is, you know, we're treated to easily dark skies wherever you go around, just with a few hours drive from a CBD location. And, you know, we can even, you know, Adelaide is even down Tasmania way in Melbourne, you get it the most. But, you know, Adelaide, we could even see a few some of the southern lights as well over the southern horizon here. So we're just far enough south as well to capture that.
Very cool. Now, because I'm not anywhere versed in the Southern Hemisphere, when do the small and large Magellanics become visible for you guys? And for those who don't know, the large and small Magellanics are the companion galaxies of the Milky Way, which is only visible in the Southern Hemisphere.
So for me, I think I can see them all year round.
Okay. I didn't realize they were nearly circumpolar or that far north. Yeah.
So that's a shot, you know, looking down, it's directly south from, you know, about 30 minutes from my house, and you can see the large and the small Magellanic Cloud there. And, you know, I think the where's the South Celestial Pole should be around about here.
Okay.
So yeah, they're always visible above the horizon down here. And yeah, they look like naked eye, easy to pick with the naked eye, just, you know, like a bright cloud in the sky. But yeah, easier to pick photographically anyway looking south.
And now, I'm sorry, do you composite the shot? So do you shoot the horizon and then shoot the Milky Way and then put them together?
I do, yeah. So composite or blend them together. So I can't track the foreground, of course, and then just blend the two together and position them, you know, position it exactly where it was on that night time as well. So yeah, no, we are lucky to have this LMC and the small Magellanic Cloud, and, you know, the two objects in those, like the Tarantula Nebula.
Mm-hmm. That's in the large.
I think it's around about there. And then you've also got 47 Tuck or Tucanae, the small globular cluster.
Oh, okay.
That's it right there next to the small Magellanic Cloud. And that's beautiful. Globular, you know, you've got Omega Centauri, which is a lot, you know, it's a globular, but then you've got, look at the small Magellanic Cloud with the 47 Tuck, and it's like a little sweet globular cluster. It's beautiful through like a 16-inch Skywatcher dove.
That's cool. Yeah. I guess it gets overshadowed because everyone here, it's like, I saw Omega Centauri. Like, that's the holy grail for the southern, well, that and Centaurus A, but those are like really southern hemisphere or really south targets that I can see Omega from my backyard.
Yeah,
barely clears the tree, and it's in a terrible part of the sky, but I've seen it where
naked, you know,
for you guys, it's no it's binoculars or with a telescope. But the telescope looks like it's like laying down practically. For you, it's like straight up.
Yeah,
most of the time,
usually straight up overhead during winter and that as well. But no, we are lucky down here in the Southern Hemisphere with the objects, and I probably should get out there and image them more. And I think it's a lot of people love to come down here, but yeah, we've got a lot of space to image.
Yeah. Are there any targets that you wish you could have more time or access to that are Northern Hemisphere based that maybe don't clear the horizon out there as well?
I mean, I guess you see all the images of the Andromeda Galaxy, and, you know, it'd be cool to, so we can image it here, but it's about 5 to 10 degrees above the horizon from here. So it's very, you need a really flat northern horizon. And, you know, somewhere up north over like a salt lake or something like that, you'll be able to capture it easily enough. But yeah, it's not that high, but it'd be good to try and image that. Besides that, and I guess, you know, for those who are who need a polar align, a equatorial mount, if we had a North Star like you guys up there, it would be a lot easier than trying to find sigma octants down here, which is sometimes a big deterrent for some people when they're trying to track, you know, for the first time, trying to find those little stars.
Yeah.
But yeah, once you get going and you do it a lot, it's actually quite easy to set up a tracker.
And for anybody who's actually watching, because we get a lot of people who like get our equatorial mounts and they're like, oh, you sent me the Southern Hemisphere reticle because it has octans in there. No, we didn't. They work in both hemispheres. I don't know how you guys were doing it when it was the old school reticle, the one that has like Cassiopeia and the Big Dipper and stuff like that. I don't understand how that was around that long or how you guys were able to do anything with something like that.
I think we managed. I think they started producing like a replacement polarscope for us down here that we were retrofitting to some of the EQ6 and HEQ5 mounts. And then, you know, with the Star Adventurer coming out, it had the correct polarscope for us to accommodate our four little stars that we have to align to.
Yeah. No, I've had so many people call up and they're like, you sent me the wrong reticle. It's like, it works in both hemispheres. So you're welcome. So when you take your tracker, you can go anywhere in the world and you're good to go. So unless you're on the equator, then sorry. just sucks. So I know a lot of people, obviously we could talk about gear all day long, but what equipment do you like to use? I know you like the Star Adventurer. Mm-hmm. We're both kind of, you know, we work for Skywatcher or represent Skywatcher. So obviously we're a little jaded when it comes to what trackers we like to use, but
nothing else.
What lenses, what cameras do you like using? I know that's a big topic in the nightscape world. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I guess, you know, I started with Canon, and a lot of people have started with Canon, and my first camera was the Canon 20D. I don't know if anyone out there has had that. I think it was about 2003, I think it came out. That was my first digital. Actually, my first camera was a film camera. So I'm not that old, but I did have a film camera to start using first. And then it was a Canon 20D with a kit lens. And, you know, that I was able to take some really nightscape images back then. And that was before the whole nightscape thing was a genre back then. So that was really, that was good. And then I've moved over to Canon, like a Canon 5D, Canon 6D. And then Sony came out with their amazing cameras. And in the last couple of years, I've, you know, kind of switched totally over to Sony, the Sony A7 series of cameras, and primarily for video originally, and just because they could offer so much at a cheaper price. But then the Sony gear just to shoot with them, they're so light and compact, and the glass on the system's really good as well. So yeah, I shoot. My main Astro camera is a Sony A7 III. It's Astro modified. So it's, you know, catered towards trying to pick up that hydrogen alpha a little bit easier. And then I have like another Sony A7 III, which I shoot for like time lapses when I'm out there. And then I have also got the Sony A7 S3. And, you know, you can capture the Milky Way at nighttime with just on video with that camera. It's like you can see in the dark. You can also sometimes like look on the back of the screen without a torch, just so you can see your surroundings. It's amazing.
I know the S version. I remember when that thing came out and I called it an A-pod in a box because it was just like, you could just point it anywhere. It was like, boop, whoa. So yeah, those S cameras from Sony are just unbelievable. So I need to try one again sometime.
So yeah, I love the Sony. And I came onto Sony after that whole star eating thing was gone.
I wasn't sure if they had fixed that. I don't track Sony.
I don't see that in the cameras that I'm using anyway. That's kind of gone. And then with the lenses, I was using Sigma Art And I've still got a Sigma Art 105 mil, which is a beast of a lens, but beautiful. It's like f1.4 at 105 mil. So I use that for some deep space objects. But my favorite lens at the moment would probably be the Sony 14 mil G Master. And that's really good. It's really sharp to the edge to edge. And, you know, shooting, I usually shoot around f2 on that lens, and it's just so light as well. Yeah, if it's enjoyable. I find it, you know, if you're not lugging so much gear out there, it's more enjoyable to shoot the night sky. You know, you can take that gear out a lot easier as well.
Yeah, that's my problem, is I bring out too much stuff and that's like, what am I going to use? And then you just end up wasting your time. So it's like, yeah, if you go out, you know, a camera, maybe you've got two lenses and like, that's it. Mm-hmm. And your tracker, and you're like set at that point. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. On your modified camera, I know we did an episode about modified cameras, but you having owned one, because you do notice in your images that a lot of that red nebulosity really pops in your shot. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming that is with your modified camera. Did you notice a major difference, A and B, from doing the modified camera, and do you recommend that for people who are, you know, serious about nightscape work?
I think, yeah. So yeah, I did notice a difference at first. It was quite noticeable. I'll share one of these images with the modified. That's from my backyard here in the Adelaide Hills.
Nuts.
So yeah, you can notice a difference straight away. That's at 24 mil panorama. So I think it's about 40 shots. And Orion's up the right way, just for jokes. But yeah, no, you do notice it straight away with a modified. It's just really easy to process and bring out that hydrogen alpha. You can still capture the same details with a non-modified, but you just probably need to expose a bit longer or have darker sky. So yeah, so that's it, it is, you can notice a difference. And I think with Nightscape, you know, trying to try and capture that hydrogen alpha really kind of really tells a better story of the Milky Way, and kind of separates as well from other photographers if you do have a astro modified camera. I found
it does give you that pop, and I think a lot of people forget just how much nebulosity, obviously down in the Southern Hemisphere there's a ton in there, but we have a bunch up here. Obviously you have like the Barnard Loop and the Rosettes in there, and the California Nebula I see down in the bottom left, and you know, there's all that up in there. And then, yeah, that's a big thing where I think people, it is hard to bring that out, but having that slight modification does make a big difference. Obviously, as you can see with yours, is it really, and it does give you like this sense of, you know, depth in the image because it just pops it more. But one of these days, I guess I'll have to try one out. But yeah, so there you go. If you think about getting your... Now, do you have the full modified, like the full spectrum, or is it just the hydrogen alpha modified?
Just the hydrogen alpha.
Okay.
And that's all I need. I think there was, when the person who modified my camera was saying, I think for Sony systems, it was there might have been a bit of light leak issue if you do a full spectrum. I think there's a company in US called Spencer Cameras. I get mine done through them.
They're the big one up here.
But I think they're one of the leaders now in the world for astro modified. I mean, you don't need an astro modified camera to shoot nightscape. I think I had an image down here, which that was with a Sony A7 S3. And that wasn't with a modified camera. So you don't need a astro modified to shoot nightscape. It's just, if you want to tell a different story.
It does give you that saturation. It's a big difference in the saturation though. So, you know, it just pops and really brings out that detail in those H2 regions up there.
Yeah, it does.
If someone wants to get started doing nightscape photography, whether you're, you know, North or South Hemisphere, is there any recommendations, you know, to get started that you know, what camera to look into, or, lenses? And obviously you shoot the Sonys, but I know what are your recommendations for someone who wants to get started?
I guess I've seen lately some really amazing shots taken with phones, smartphones.
Yeah,
it's like, whoa. It's like, it's kind of like where technology was maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago, what they're achieving with nightscape images. So that's, if you've got a phone, you might be already able to do it straight away. But if you want to, like, you know, get it into like a digital SLR or a mirrorless camera, I still think, you know, if you can pick up like a secondhand Canon 6D out there, I think that's still one of the best astro nightscape cameras on the market. So Canon 6D, I know they're discontinued now, but that's still, that was the leader out there before, you know, the progression of into mirrorless cameras in, and, you know, partnering up that with like a wide 14 mil lens and a sturdy tripod. And that's, you know, that's kind of all you need to get going. And, you know, with that kind of setup, you know, you can take probably maximum like 30 second exposures, and, you know, you can be able to, and you better, you know, if you dark enough skies, you better really bring out that Milky Way, and really dark skies, you might better bring out a bit of color as well in that Milky Way. So that's kind of like the base, you know, and you can, and you might not need a Canon 6D. You might need a cheaper camera. If you can at least, you know, something that can take longer exposures to bring out the night sky, that's kind of all you need to start with.
Yeah, anything like the Rebels or, you know, the really any modern day DSLR is generally pretty well suited as far as it's like inboard processors to handle stuff. So yeah, it's really just that long exposure bulb mode or manual mode that you're really looking for, and then obviously a nice lens goes a long way with those. I've seen people do really nice stuff with the kit lenses, which I know that's how I think both of us started, but you find out really quick, it's like, oh, if I had a lens that was f2.8 or if I had a lens that was f2 or 1.4 or 1.2, that makes a humongous difference, especially if you don't have a tracker at that moment. And you said you also use like a 24 millimeter as well.
Yeah.
Do you find the need to go longer much?
Yeah, so I mean, my main style of photography is like panoramas. So if I go longer focal length, that means there's a lot more images to take. So I have shot up to 50 mil or like 105 mil. I had the Sigma 105 mil with on the new Star Adventure GTI, and I was did a like a 30 image panorama with that on that mount, and that worked beautiful. So that really brought out the core of the Milky Way, like Rio Fuki, and then through Scorpius and that as well. So
it is nice to have that increased like resolution. I mean, obviously it's a monster project to be able to do a big old mosaic at longer focal lengths, but when you actually, you're zoomed in already that much, and then you're using a camera that's like 20 megapixels and you stitch all that together, it's just this beautiful high resolution shot. But those, like you have said, those shots require some effort. So obviously for some people it's easier just to do one big lens and boom, but I'm a big fan of doing mosaics and stuff like that for that really high res wide field shot. So
hopefully the GTI might be able to do that for us automatically one day soon.
It would be cool if it would, the Star Adventure GTI did built-in mosaics, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would, maybe.
Watch this space. Take a look at, we'll have to keep an eye out for that.
Yep.
So, I know you've been playing with that. Do you find, I know there's a lot of people out there that haven't had a chance to play with the Star Adventure GTI as of this recording. They're coming. Stop asking. They're coming. Do you find, having shot with the Star Adventure and now with the GTI, the go-to function really helps you out much? Or what do you like about that compared to the two eyes and the standard models?
Yeah, I mean, the go-to, you know, if you're chasing deep sky objects, for starters, you know, your longer focal length, if you're using like a 400 mil, you know, even like maybe a 200 mil, and you're not that sure of the night sky, you really want to center those deep space objects, then, you know, it's so much easier than trying to manually move your scope around the night sky. So there's that. I think the really good thing about it, especially for the Southern Hemisphere, it's got that, the inbuilt polar alignment feature.
Yeah.
Yeah, which we probably should talk about more. You know, I think we've got it and Celestron have got it as well. How that, you know, once you do that rough polar alignment, you can fine tune the polar alignment. And, you know, a lot of people add on like little polar scopes and even laser pointers and that as well. But you know, it's already built into all the Skywatcher mounts. So that having that feature for like a lighter kind of nightscape go-to type of you know, portable mount, you know, that's excellent.
Yeah.
And then of course, you know, if you partnering that. You go, mate.
I was going to say, I don't mean to be cutting you off and stuff like that all the time, so I apologize. Yeah. On the polar alignment feature, all you have to do is like a one-star alignment, like obviously get it close. This is with all of our equatorial go-to mounts. You know, get it close, do a one-star, and then the polar alignment option opens up, and then you can go through the prompts and it tells you what to do, and then that'll help you adjust your overall alignment, even if you can't see Polaris. Or you're having a hard time, you know, doing that, it's in there. So
yeah, that's right. Yeah. And you know, we don't have those bright Polaris like you guys have, so that really does help us down here for that. And I think, yeah, it's just having that, I like it, you know, that light, like I was saying back to Sony, having a light set up you know, to go out makes it more enjoyable than, you know, having a smaller equatorial mount and a smaller, you know, focal length telescope. Just you probably use it more and, you know, take it out there. It's a lot easier to set up and portable as well. So
I know that's kind of my downfall, is I have a bunch of stuff, but you know, kids at home, you work all day. If your stuff's not already set up by the time you get home, you're probably not gonna, I mean, everyone here knows what that's like. So yeah, having a setup that you can basically, I mean, you could put one of like our Evo Luxes or the, you know, Evo Star 72 on that and have a whole little system. I have a ZWO ASI Air that controls mine, and to have that whole little setup and just go boop boop and pop that out in the backyard. I mean, it's not set up, but it's all put together. You know, yeah, it's not some big refractor with some big old thing on it, but you're out imaging with it at this point. So yeah, I think it's going to be an awesome little mount once it gets out into the world as well. I think they're very convenient.
I think they are. And I'll still keep using the 2i. And I also use the Star Adventurer Mini here as well. I think that little mount, you know, matched with like a mirrorless Sony system, it's excellent. It's just so, I mean, it's the size of an apple.
Yeah.
That Mini. And, you know, that's all you need with a wide field lens. And then, yeah, with the 2i, I'll keep using that as well, you know, for my real portable setups.
Yeah, I find they're really good companions to each other. You know, the GTI is... it's a real mount at that point. So, you know, and I know there's a bunch of customers that we've had, I'm sure you've had as well, where they get a Star Adventure and they're like, okay, where do I point it? How do I find Andromeda? How do I find whatever? I know a lot of people out there coming in from the photo world, that go-to function is a very, very helpful little thing to do. But also if you're just trying to build like a little imaging rig, now you can have an automated system if you have a computer or the ASI Air, and you know, if you want to do a big chunk of the sky, right now you can program that with an ASI Air and go to sleep, and it'll automate that system for you. So having that go-to feature is a big advantage. But like you said, the Mini is another one that I feel like gets overlooked by a lot of people because it doesn't have the bigger payload capacity of like the 2i, but if you're backpacking, if you're just doing like 24 or 35 millimeter and smaller, like that's really what that little mount is all about. Yep. I like the time-lapse feature on it, the pan.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
That's so I think the Mini gets overlooked quite a bit, but I think it's a really useful little tool beyond just a star tracker. But it's, I think a lot of people overlook it because they do want to do the bigger payload, longer focal length stuff.
And that's the ultimate goal, isn't it? As you, I think you guys said, the Star Adventure is the gateway to astronomy. Mm-hmm. Yep. And it definitely is.
But the Mini is definitely something I think more people should take time to consider. But I feel like the Mini is a little bit more of a specialized tool than the larger one is. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have to need those features, but man, is it, I mean, you could keep that in your camera bag and it doesn't take up any room. So
no, it's very light, like a size of an apple.
Yeah. So obviously you do a lot of nightscape work, but you also do regular astrophotography as well from time to time, I assume.
I try when I get time, yes. Yeah. I do like the nightscape. I found that, you know, try and be a amateur at everything, or try and, you know, focus on one type of astrophotography. So I do like my nightscape, and that, you know, that's led to, you know, a couple of APODs out there as well with that. But yeah, with deep space, I guess it's just having the time to set up that full rig. Yeah. And, you know, I do have a 150 Esprit sitting in my garage here, so I should probably get out and use it a bit more.
There's so many people that are probably like dying at the moment, being like, you don't use it, just send it to me, I'll use it. So,
yeah. Use it more.
But, you know, it's awfully convenient to do nightscape when the Milky Way is right outside your house. So
it is. And the luxury, I live on a bit of an acreage here, so I can just leave the camera out at nighttime and go to sleep, the lazy version, and just capture a time lapse of it rising or something like that. So
the only thing that's going to run off with your camera are the big old spiders or snakes you guys have out there in the outback.
We've got a few of them around.
I know you've sent me pictures of, you know, what's on the car today and all that fun stuff. So it's part of living in in that part of the world. So, but, no, that's cool. Do you find, so this is where I think it gets really interesting, because obviously in the US, and even North America, there's like, I've even talked to this with like the UK distributors as well. It's very interesting to see, I wouldn't say culturally, but it's different. It's interesting to see what equipment people are interested in different parts of the world. And, you know, here in the US, it's right now it's small, fast, you know, little refractors and stuff like that. I'm curious, and, you know, you do go to the star parties and you see the, you know, really big daubs and stuff like that. But what are some of the trends in Australia that you tend to see? And I know that in a way is kind of a loaded question, because everything in Australia is also more expensive because of the import and how hard it is to get it there. But where, for your customers, what's kind of the hot thing right now that they tend to like to gravitate to?
I think we do follow a lot along what the US is doing. So it is, you know, small mounts, small refractors, and, you know, trying to have like quick results to get, you know, take a beautiful image and then, you know, post it on social media, have a quick result. So there is that. And then, you know, for the equatorial mounts, EQ6R is selling really well, and then, you know, matching that with like an 80 mil, like an Evo Star or the Evo Lux, or like the Esprit 80 mil or 100 mil. That's kind of like the sweet spot for astrophotographers out there at the moment with that. And then we also, you know, we get the ones who really want a dedicated setup with the EQ8R mount, and you know, matching that with a nice Esprit 150, you know, both for visual or for astrophotography. I think my best ever view of Saturn was through an Esprit 150. I think Saturn was like a zenith.
I ran out of eyepieces on an Esprit 150. Yeah. We think we were up 2.3 millimeter on night. And it was just like, I don't have anything left. So that's it. So
it was,
but they,
it looked like a NASA image through the eyepiece. It was amazing.
Yeah.
With our night skies over here, because we're so dark, Dobsonians always been a great seller in Australia. You know, that's promoted through the astronomical societies and that as well. But, you know, having an 8-inch or a 10-inch Dobsonian as a first scope is, you know, it's very popular. I think the 8-inch is probably one of the most popular sizes.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Do you guys see many of the really large, you know, daubs, like when you're starting to go half meter or bigger? Mm-hmm. I know at our major star parties out like Texas and stuff like that, you know, you will see Dobsonians that are 20-inch or half meter and bigger. Do you get a lot of those down there?
Yeah, there's a few. I think a lot of custom builds. I think there's one custom place here in Australia that makes the big dobs, and I think I've looked through like a 30 and like a 36-inch Dobsonian, and yeah, some of the view. Yeah, it's amazing. Seeing like color in the Tarantula Nebula. Looking at like Eta Carina, and seeing like the little split in the center star as well. So yeah, we do have the big Dobbs, and I think there's a star party here, and I've seen the guy, he arrives with it on his truck. He's 36 inch or 40 inch it might have been. So we do have them. But I think my favorite Dob is, I've got one here in my garage, is the 16 inch Skywatcher Dob, non-go-to. I love non-go-to feature, just so I can manually push it around the night sky and remind myself where to find things. But that, I find that match with is it the 16 mil Ethos, is it? Or yeah, 17 mil Ethos? Yeah, 17 mil Ethos. You know, that combination is, yeah. You know, you can see the Horsehead Nebula under the dark skies with it. I've been able to,
I've owned a couple Dobbs. A 10 inch. I have a 16 inch. I've had a 20, and I've got my 28. It's finally done now. And a 16 is such a sweet size because it's not too big. It's not too small. It is a noticeable jump over a 12 inch. Mm-hmm. And it's definitely one of the, you've entered the big boy category when you've started to hit the 15, 16 inch mark. Because there's not much on those charts you can't hit in a dark sky with a 16. I mean, like you said, the Horsehead, not really that difficult with a 16 inch. And that's a big, you know, jump for a lot of people. And I don't know about you, but galaxies in a 16 inch just pop on another level compared to, you know, anything really smaller than that. So regardless of who makes it, but I mean, I do think the 16 is a very nice size if you're looking for something that's not super big, but it's not small either. So that's especially under dark skies.
Yeah, no, you're right. And it is portable. I mean, you can collapse that 16 down as well. I remember I had a sedan, a four-seat sedan, and I used to put the 16-inch tube on the back seat and then collapse the base and put it into the we call it the boot or the trunk over here. So I was able to go to like star parties with a 16-inch in the back seat. So it is kind of portable, but it is a big mount. But yeah, the views through it. And I've had, you know, fellow friends look through it and look through like a 20-inch custom build, and there's not much of a difference there between the...
Yeah, if you had them side by side, you would see the difference, but there's only about a half magnitude difference between a 16 and a 20, which is noticeable, but it's not something that would, if you didn't have them together, it wouldn't be the end of the world. Because the 20 is only going to inch it out just a little bit more. But it's also a lot more effort. A 20 is a lot bigger telescope too that you got to lug around, and you might need a trailer, or, you know, it doesn't fit in a sedan. That's freaking sure. So
no, that's right. Maybe the Stargate, but
anyway. Maybe. But yeah, I loved all my scopes, but yeah, once you hit 20, you really need to kind of consider what you're getting yourself into. I mean, they're worth it in my opinion, but they are compared to like a 16 is a nice companion scope. Well, it's a serious companion scope. If you're like an imager and it's running all night, you could bring a 16 inch out and be busy all night. I mean, you could do that with a 20, but a 20 and like an imaging system, a 20 is not a companion telescope most of the time. It is the telescope, and of course anything bigger than that is, you better know what you're getting yourself into and committing to making that happen. So
no you're right. I think,
is there anything,
sorry, I was gonna say, have you found recently that I think I've actually had comments, people saying that the Skywatcher mirrors are getting better. I don't know what they're actually doing in the factory, but you know, comparing to what people could see 10 years, 15 years ago, the quality of the mirror is just getting a lot better. You know, you pull out a crisp new 16 inch Dob and look at an object, and it's amazing, the views through it.
Yeah, I mean, you and I have been to the factory, and I know a lot of people are like, oh, that's made in China. Wow, they've been doing this a long time. I mean, of course, if it's like, hey, can you make me a 20 inch F3? Like, hey, you might have a problem making one of those, but for the stuff they do make, I mean, they really know what they're doing. I was going to make a daub out of one of our Quattro 300 mirrors, the 12-inch F4. And I gave it to a friend of mine to make this scope, and it kind of fell through, and I have more scopes than I know what to do with. So it got moved. The project got moved around. But anyway, he tested the mirror for me just for the heck of it. Mm-hmm. And it was just stock. I had this thing sitting on the floor of my garage in itself for like a year and a half, layer of dust on it. It was just sitting there from some trashed out Quattro that was damaged. And it was a 0.94 Strel primary. That was right out of the box. No one touched it. I couldn't have told you that until he measured it, but it was just like, and obviously don't just go out and buy one of our mirrors and expect it to be like that every time, but a 12-inch F4 is a fairly fast optic on its own, and to have that kind of, you know, caliber, I mean, you pay a lot of money for a mirror like that custom to almost those same specs. So, but yeah, I've had friends of mine who are mirror makers look through some of our scopes and just like, hey, what do you think? And they'll star test it. And obviously it's mass production, so not everything's going to be, you know, a ringer, but they know what they're doing. They've been making these mirrors for a long time, so they know what's acceptable and what's not. So it does drive me nuts when people are like, ah, it's made in China. It's like, okay, well, they're like master opticians that are making these things, and they're quite good. So
yeah,
just because it doesn't have someone's like name on it doesn't mean it's necessarily bad, or it's cheap doesn't mean it's bad. It just means there's a lot of them out there. So. But no, I think they're very nice mirrors. They, you know, even like the Esprits, anybody who's ever used an Esprit, it's like you said earlier, it's really impressive what that scope can throw down. Not even knowing anything, I don't know anything about my Esprit 150's optic. I just know it's nice. So, but no, obviously nowadays they are highly regarded as a really nice refractor. So they give them credit where credit's due. The engineers and the people actually at Skywatcher who build these really know what they're doing. So
they do, yeah.
I don't think they get enough credit a lot of times, because obviously we're the front line. You're the front line for Australia. We're the front line. You know, people tell us, but it doesn't make it back to the people who actually make it and work on it. So
no,
but they do a nice job. So. Thanks for...
And yeah, and the views are amazing. I just like your comment on the Esprit, just, you know, comparing that to the competition out there, the value that you get in, say, like a 100 mil Esprit is, you know, compared to the competition, it's amazing the results that people are achieving. We just ran a Skywatcher Australia astrophotography competition, and some of the, you know, just seeing the results of people entering photos taken through Esprits and through Quattros, and even like some images were taken through Dobbs as well, some solar system images. And just, yeah, some of the quality of the images, they're you know, the APOD quality out there, and what they're achieving through an affordable scope.
Yeah, that's like the name of the game now. You don't have to spend a large amount of money anymore to get something really nice. But I mean, you're seeing that everywhere. You know, you have Sigma and Tamron. Yep. You know, I remember several years ago where it's like, oh my God, you bought one of those? Now, they like rival some of the name brand glass that's out there. And I think it's pretty much the same thing where you either start making really nice stuff or you get out of the game, because people's expectations now are getting higher. You know, people want more for their money. But that's the expectation nowadays, is you have to make something nice. And if we can't, then get out of the way. So,
yep, that's it.
Since we both represent Skywatcher, is there anything that you think would be cool? I mean, obviously, both of us know what's being worked on and can't discuss that. But is there anything that you would like to see Skywatcher come out with, like, in the future that we've never done before?
Dobbs, you know, bigger Dobbs are always good. So yeah, possibly, and maybe bigger Dobbs. I don't know if they can do that. Mm-hmm. But then I guess you have to be portable as well. So
yeah, it's a downfall. Like, okay, let's make a 24-inch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think just like portable. You know, we're covering a lot of bases with astrophotography. You know, with our Quattros and Esprits and that. You know, the quality is already there. So I guess it's just, you know, feeding off that and what we've done well with that. You know, if it's you know, bigger refractors or smaller refractors along those markets. So, you know, that's probably would be really nice to see. But, you know, we've already got the products there to do the results. So. Mm-hmm.
I would love an Esprit 180. A 7-inch Esprit would be like, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think we'd sell many of them because they're going to be expensive, but it would be awesome. So
Esprit 180. Okay, I didn't think of that one, but yeah, that's good.
Esprit 180 nice. F7 with an F5.4 reducer for full frame.
Yeah, and a
really big EQ8 mount to hold it. So,
yep.
I mean, the 150 is no small refractor either. So,
no, it's not.
7 would be noticeable. So,
mm-hmm. But yeah, no, you know, we've got the Star Adventure GTI. Hopefully, we'll be landing here in Australia in about 3 weeks' time for us. Mm-hmm. So it'd be great to see, you know, the results of people matching them up to small refractors out there, or, you know, larger telephoto lenses, and seeing the results that they're going to be able to take with them. I think it's just opening up that whole deep space market for them.
Now, the GTI, I think, will do really, really nicely. I've been impressed with it. I tested it with a Canon 600 F4 Mark III lens.
Yep.
No problem.
That's good.
It shot really nice with it. I just wish I had better weather at the time of having that lens with me to really push it. But I do think that go-to tracker mixture is really what, especially if you're coming from the photographic market, that's a huge plus for a lot of people.
It is, yeah.
I know we're getting to the end here. Normally, this is when we open it up to Q&A, but since this is pre-recorded, sorry. Do you have a website, Will, if people want to see what you're doing and up to, or you're primarily on Instagram, aren't you?
Yeah, I have a website, but my Instagram tag is Godward Photography. That's just my name and photography. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm probably the most active, with my photography shoots. I haven't been that active over the last 6 months till my number 3 daughter arrived. So
congratulations.
I've been, a little bit, sidetracked with that.
Yeah. Busy.
Busy, yes, busy. But yeah, no, I'm looking forward to getting out there. We're starting to come to the season where you start capturing the arc of the Milky Way over the western horizon. So I've got a few compositions that planned that I'm going to try and achieve coming into the season. So yeah, but yeah, Godward Photography is where you can keep up to date. And that's nice. Facebook or Instagram as well. So.
And then, you work with, particularly, you work with Skywatcher Australia, but that is TSA in Australia is the main company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so TSA is our company, and you know we're distributors for Skywatcher, also distributors for Celestron as well, and other optics brands. So yeah, I think it's about a 54-year-old company down here, and yeah, we've been distributing, I think, Skywatcher for I think over 20 years now. Down here, so yeah, it's become part of the family a brand for us, and yeah, it's great to see, and you know, especially through the last few years through COVID, to see the increase in astronomers and astrophotographers out there wanting to get into the hobby for us down here in Australia.
No, it's been very good, I think, for everyone, and I think it's been good for the hobby too. So it's nice to see that's, you know, an international thing, mm-hmm. that our hobby globally is growing. So
yeah,
you got anything you want to add? Because that's pretty much our hour at this point.
No, that's been good. No, thanks for having me on, Kevin. And
absolutely. No. We'll have to have you back on or do a virtual star party from the Southern Hemisphere or something.
I was
crazy
thinking
like that.
I think we could do that. Maybe it might be in the middle of the night for me, but I could do that. We could do a live stream looking over the night sky.
No, we might have to do that. So we'll talk about that. Cool. Well, thank you very much for hanging out with us, Will. For those of you who are hanging out with us today, thanks a lot. If you have any questions for Will, just shoot them over to us through the info@skywatcherusa.com and we can send them over to him, or check out his Instagram. And if you're in Australia, good for you. Check out TSA if you're looking for any of your optical needs. They've got a bunch of that. Not to be confused with the TSA travel thing here in the United States. Very separate things.
Yep.
But anyway, have a great weekend, everyone. We will catch you next week for our What's Up in the Nighttime Sky episode for July. And Will, thank you very much and have a good rest of your day.
Thanks, Kevin.
All right. See you guys. Bye.